be sharing some of your stuff as well. So thank you. Over to you, Fabrizio.
I think Barreto was great because he's giving me a very good sign that we both have Formula One notes in our presentation. And actually what I'm trying to explain in our talk is that even the Temblue Link SEO compared to when you do news, you could turn that into some sort of Formula One and not just slowly pile up pages waiting for Google at some point to crawl them, index, and eventually rank. So what I do, I work at TransferWise, where I look after organic growth in SEO. It's pretty much the team that builds platform, products, content. And what I'm going to talk about, actually what I'm not going to talk about today is give you any specific recommendation on any particular platform, right? We already have a second code for journal, you know, suggesting what to use. And also what I'm not going to talk about is specific to like some of the stuff that you should definitely do. For your platform, I will include that, but I will try to group topics and learnings from us building our platform that I think could be applied regardless of where you are. Just 1 second. And in the meantime, you can switch. Sorry, we're trying to have a video, which is the usual impossible thing that goes into any presentation. So, watch this. If you watch this video for a few seconds, you will realize that the Formula One team, in about 2 seconds, changed managed to do a pit stop versus in the 1950s, there was a guy hammering, literally, the wheel, hoping that something was about to come up. We won't watch the entire video because in the meantime, the Ferrari Formula One managed to do probably 20, 30 pit stops. This guy is still hammering one of the wheel, but I think this is a great analogy for how people interact with CMS. And a great analogy on how people interact with developers and how they build websites. And I think we can. Sorry. Technology. Okay, perfect. And I think like if you look at like a Formula One team and you compare it to your team, your SEO team, or your entire team building your website, you have a bunch of engineers that could be compared to mechanics, designers, and all these people that build a car, but also help with some of the operation. You have SEO guys that like eventually are on the driving seat to some extent, if they are, sometimes not. And then you have the car, which is roughly your website. And then like what the other bit that people really talk about in talks and in SEO is that eventually everything will have to happen, in the case you're working with the CMS, obviously, through a CMS. And like in this particular talk, we will not dive particularly into any CMS, as I mentioned, but what we will try to do, we will try to go deep on some particular characteristic that I think that any CMS could eventually have. And the other bit is that when it comes to, you know, our industry in general, you have people like Barry Alida that come and tell you what is the generic application of any given problem. We're talking about the Shark Land, we're talking about progressive web, but there is rarely time to go in depth on a certain platform, right? And let's try to do a little thing. How many people do SEO for, you know, you think you're an SEO in the room? Raise the hand. Okay. How many think that, keep the hands up, 1 second. How many think that they have a very in-depth knowledge of any content management system? And okay, there are still few. And then how many of these ever built one? Okay, we still have one. If you're missing John, otherwise you would probably raise his hands as well. But point being is that we often talk a lot about building website, but actually most of our recommendation and most of the time that we speak to, you know, if you're an agency with a client or sometimes, you know, the most recurring question that I have in me trying to hire people to help us build the TransferWise website is that, you know, a couple of years experience in SEO, they mentioned that they have experience in technical SEO, and they don't know what CMS their client is working on, right? Which is quite shocking. Like, how can you manage to change all these things that you told them, right, without knowing that? And that is terrible because basically, sorry, going back to the slide, think about Formula One today, right? Think about the CMS as your like steering wheel and try to drive a Formula One of today with that knowledge of the steering wheel. And that's pretty much what some of the people are doing, right? They send to, you know, they are either the SEO team or they send to their client a bunch of recommendation on how to do SEO, and they hope that, you know, they have zero knowledge of all the steps that are involved in actually making any of this change, and then they hope that this thing somehow drives the performance at some point. But that doesn't happen, right? So every year you make a bunch of plans, you forecast some growth, you're gonna make some changes, this growth will never happen. And actually the performance at which you manage to grow your site, your stack, in our case, you know, when we started TransferWise, TransferWise was one page. Right, so there was a talk previously talking about how we don't do in building because we had other problems, right? We can build all the links that they want, but we had no pages. So and most of the people probably, yes, they have a fairly established site with pages, but there is still a bunch of things that, you know, could go very slow and very wrong when you actually try to optimize these pages, or maybe when you try to capture new audiences through new content. And this is not entirely our fault to some extent, because obviously there's a bunch of things that we need to learn as SEO. There are like so many platforms, and I worked in a few of these platforms. As SEO, there are platforms that we don't really like, and despite them trying very hard, but then there are also platforms that we like, right? So at the same time, we know very little. My first client had Magento e-commerce, and they were asking me to contribute to any technical decision. I knew nothing about it, right? About the actual platform itself. And then they ask you to fix what is broken, right? So again, another client, this is on Sitecore. Again, no understanding of what will happen beyond that HTML that is on the page. Everything in the back like was complete unknown, or otherwise, this was most of my consulting times. That's probably why I left it. Adobe CQ5, and like all these enterprise, I mean, now it's like experience manager, I don't know the name, but basically what happens is that you have this massive enterprise CMS, beautiful, with one page about this is how we handle redirect. And you could customize your URL. Wow, that's really fancy, right? Like that's how you're gonna fly with this. And then at the same time, when you're in the room with, you know, imagine you get to the point where you're in the room to work with some developers on actually building a platform and developing a website, you're often asked to make choices that you don't really, you really struggle to quantify the impact in the very short term. In this case, we're talking about like whether to have a very modern architecture that on day one makes no difference. I just want this page out, it needs to rank for something, happy days, right? But then on the long run, when we need to build 5 million of these pages, yes, this could make a difference, right? And then often what happens, like, you know, I'm not saying that it's always the case, you will have this very management consulting type of chart where you put your, you know, the features of each of these CMS and you try to scale which one does better for your business. And then that's how most of the company end up choosing at some point, right? But in reality, what happens, this is too blurry for me to read, unfortunately. This is our process to get to publish one page. In reality, what happens is that there's a lot happening in the background. It's not just a simple choice of, you know, this is how we make an hreflang tag, or this is how we implement this particular element of technical SEO. There's a bunch of people that we do some stuff. That's the initial stage where we do keyword research and validation. This is the stage where we go through the copywriters and we brief them. This is the stage where we implement tracking, and then we start building a couple of tests of this page, the winning test, we go out, and then we start to track the keywords and then do a bunch of activities. But reality is that like what we generally know and what are us interfacing with people building website is way more complicated than that. It's most likely a spreadsheet with a list of things to change, and then we hope that this is gonna happen. And that's why like when I joined TransferWise, at that time we had nothing, we had no CMS, there was a couple of WordPress installation that we chopped. And we decided to build, one of the engineers one day came back and said, oh, I built this thing. Okay, now we may as well do something with it. So this is the answer, our platform to build landing pages. It's very simple, Spring Boot, Team Leaf. There's a couple of React components here and there that we build. And this is the platform that to date we use to publish most of our stuff, even though some of the components that we modularize them to a particular product. And then, like, obviously, I understand that not everyone is in the same situation in which we are, right? Maybe you already have an organization, the actual teams, developers, infrastructure teams, everything. So obviously, is very difficult, and that's what I call the thermometer for developers, right? You go into this level of frustration where if you're starting from scratch or moving to a new platform where you have fairly good understanding that you like it, this is gonna go really well. If your team has got chances to work with that team that owns the platform in case it's already established, happy days, it's gonna be painful, but happy days. You get to the stage where actually there's something in place, you have no chance that you can touch it, and then basically you're better off doing something else, right? There's very little that you can do. And In our case, another element that helped us in doing that and is basically building a full stack team. So from day one, and again, I understand that it's not eventually possible everywhere, but the more you try to lean towards that direction, the more you will have control on what you build and the less you will stop sending the recommendation that will never happen. And then going back to basic, right? So if you think about our growth, this is just like, you know, something to give you some prep on like what I mean. If you think about our growth with having zero pages on our website, it could be the same if you need to optimize and stuff like that. You know, the customers that you drive to your company is somehow, you know, related to the number of unique pages and content that you release, which will capture a certain amount of volume, that will have a certain amount of CTR, that will have a certain amount of conversion rate, happy days, you have customers. And we did that, right? Over the past 3 years, we built two CMS. We actually one for blog, one for content, one for landing pages. We have 3 SEO working on these, 15 people publishing content in 12 languages, 17 countries, and we got to roughly 3 million index pages in a couple of years. Not all these are like made via CMS, but a good portion of that. On the blog, for instance, we published something like 1,000-1,500 articles per year from zero. So we started to scale this process. And what we learned about that, and that's why I'm really passionate about this stuff, is that actually the speed at which we grow is the speed at which we can optimize and shift changes. It's not down to us having better technical recommendation than other people, right? Think about, again, the HR language example. If you get it right, you get it right. It's not that like the other website in SERP, they have a more beautiful HR language, right? They also got it right. Your chance to win against them, again, thinking about Formula One, is how fast can I implement all these things? And as you can see, this chart is, we take Search Analytics API, we plot it into Looker, which is a business intelligent tool. I did a count of pages indexed with one click, so which means that somehow meaningful pages, not just pages for the sake of it. And I put the traffic together with it. This is clicks from search. As you can see, there's quite clear correlation between these two things happening. I'm not telling you how much traffic, but at this point we have roughly 3 million pages indexed. And what I learned also by hiring a bunch of people that will start making content, producing landing pages across multiple markets, is that people don't scale, right? So one guy can make that many articles in a day, in a month, and that's it, right? There's a certain amount of hours in a day. And unfortunately, the only way to scale, you know, beyond getting it right, is to really nail operation. And that's why many people, I think, they really get it wrong, or the reason why they don't grow as much is because their ability to get something implemented is like 7 months down the line, where we did it yesterday. And so what I'm going to talk about today, sorry, this was a bit of a longer intro, but what I'm going to share with you today is 4 key learning that we have from building this. Literally, when this CMS was first developed, we had nothing. Like, you know, anyone could go and basically, there were teams hacking it, literally, building their own CMS inside this. So it was like beyond nothing. And so over time, we invested time into this, and we grouped roughly 4 categories that we think that over time really helped us in scaling. And I think that the point of this is that you could do this everywhere, right? Obviously, there are platforms and setup where this might be a little bit more complicated, but actually, there's very little chance that it's quite likely that this is not possible elsewhere. Obviously, you know, the more complicated is your organization versus us, for instance, owning beginning to the end, having engineers in the team, this could be more complicated, but some of this stuff you could do it pretty much everywhere, I think. That's why I didn't want to deep dive into specific of a platform or specific of anything. And the first one is accessibility. So what I mean by accessibility is a list of features, right, that SEO platform should have, right? So we want to have canonicals, we want to have structured data, we want to have metadata, like this very basic stuff, right? And when it comes to development, especially on the priorities, when it comes to prioritize this stuff, what we learn over time, especially because the developers sit in our team, is that it's really important to not just give them a restaurant menu and hope that they're going to choose, right? Like, we have a list of features that we really wanted. On day one, we had none of these. So I think compared to other places where you may already have a CMS that handles some of the stuff, again, whatever you want to fix, always try to work out based on the priority what you need to do. And the way that we do it, I don't think it's rocket science, right? Is we don't do it, right? We publish 1 million URLs without having an XML sidebar, and with our lead engineer telling us, oh, you should make better internal linking structure. Googlebot is smart enough, right? And with those us screaming not having an XML sidebar, but still it worked, right? And it kind of forced us to do some stuff better. There's a second stage where we hack it. So again, we probably ask an engineer how this thing works, but no engineers will spend a second on it. The SEO were relatively strong technically, try to figure out how to build this themselves. And then because of a sitemap, you just do it manually, right? You just end up like getting a dump from the database. You will end up building it and then uploading it every and there. And this is not ideal because we keep publishing pages, keeps changing, and then, you know, again, this is not gonna last long. What we do at this stage, we put KPIs against that, because obviously we don't want to build a team of monkeys that every month go and update things. And what we try to do is we put KPIs on the scaling. When stuff doesn't scale, that's where we use developer resources. And then the other bit when it comes to features for accessibility, like general SEO stuff that we like to have when we work, we spend a lot of time figuring out what has to be handled by the platform versus what has to be handled by human, with the assumption that human fuck up, right? Like, that's like, there's no given, right? It's like, and they're slow as well. One example of it is hreflang. So, good luck teaching everyone, no matter how much they're a good marketing manager, how does it work, right? Good luck teaching it to developers, right? After 3 years into this, 1 month ago, we got a developer who rewrote our, like, we are on .com with subfolders. We have a developer who rewrote our architecture and say, I think this could be a better idea. Like, no, it's like we did it for 3 years, right? In this way, why should we? So what we try to do in this case, we try to understand really well where the user input should be and where the platform should handle it. So in the case of the hreflang, if you're a user building a page, you have two choices that you need to make. Tell me the language or country that you're targeting, and then tell me the topic of your page. Then what we have, we build a library where we have the mapping with all the country, with all the folders, with all the stuff that we need to do, internal architect, navigation of the stuff. And this library handles the magic. So if you go to a hreflang example, the user basically only picked two things, but then what we do, we concatenate their choice in terms of language with our structure when it comes to hreflang. We use the key as identifier of that page so we can match this page in all the languages. And then again, the mapping library does all the URL folder, blah, blah, blah. So we avoid them getting creative, right? And they can still fuck up, right? So they can still choose French on an English page. I don't know why, but at least this helps us removing some of this pain. And then when we keep investing on these features that people use, we always go very in depth on actually how people use it, right? So when I was, for instance, consulting, I never spent a second with any of my clients going through how they were implementing some of my recommendations, or at least very little, right? Some of these were quite open to explain me how this stuff was working. Some people didn't want us to know. So we were releasing, a website for a private bank, and we couldn't open the website until it was live. So like completely redesigned, launched website, we couldn't open it until it was live for security reasons. So in that case, you know, sorry, you have no choices, but what we do quite aggressively, we try to understand at which level and which user. So this is in progress, it's not really happening very well, because people started to fuck up massively. People started to delete pages, people started to chop elements out of pages because they thought that in that market was not a good idea. So we understand the level of users. So we have SEOs, we have people who work in page channels where they can duplicate but don't play with the index stuff, they can still get access to APIs. And then we got the regional marketing managers and content people that they cannot touch SEO features because we already know that they will get it wrong. But what they can do a bunch of changes that in case they flag any massive red flag, we have to approve, right? So this stuff, like, I think, and again, regardless of any organization, whether you can touch any of these within your organization, you could still go deeper in understanding what is the process, and at least build, you know, you don't have to build it within the platform if building within the platform is complicated, but you could do it on the side. And I think most of the people lose out by just talking about what has to be, you know, the outcome of this particular recommendation versus actually going in depth on how do we make this happen, right? Because that's actually where most of the time, apart from like you thinking about it, gets spent. And the second area is monitoring. I'm sorry for the people, and eventually if you have sponsor, you'll talk about crawlers and the things to monitor the site, but one thing that really, you know, at least annoys me and the people in the team, at some point everything was crawling our own site. It's like, you know, I understand that that is a good idea, right? I understand that you got used to use Screaming Frog, I lost Screaming Frog, and eventually you could use any other tool. why do we need to crawl something that we own, right? So you going into a page and press update, what it's going to do is going to post changes to our Postgres database, and which we hooked up with Looker or Metabase, which is a business intelligence tool, and this should already tell me what changed, right? Like, I understand that there are changes that, you know, the development team could do and stuff like that, but for the sake of people using a content management platform, I don't need to crawl my own site to figure out what changed. I should know, right? Again, not everyone is in the same situation, but I think that this is a point of like where any company could work out into building some sort of monitoring inside your platform rather than just monitoring from the outside. The monitoring outside use case is still valuable. I don't think that the people building this tool are out of the common sense, because there are many use cases where people should do this. But then in the case of you owning completely your own stack, why should we ask someone to monitor our own database? And what we do is very simple. Initially we were using Metabase, which is open source, I think. Now we build some stuff that feed into Looker, which is our analytics and where we analyze our data. And this is accessible to anyone, to the point where we can identify perpetrators. What I mean by perpetrators is people who want to fuck up our ranking. And what we do, we integrate it with a bot on Slack. If tomorrow you go to my most important page and you put it as no index, I send you a notification, and until that thing is fixed, you won't be able to publish, or at least you know why this has happened. And we do this for a lot of things, not just basic SEO feature like no index, with a very important block of a page that we knew that was getting all feature snippet. And suddenly someone in our original team thought that that set of pages in the order of 100 would have been better off without half of the content and removing the best block of our pages that was getting featured in the snippet. And this is the kind of stuff that you could build a simple rule and say, if in all these set of pages this block of content is missing, send this guy a notification and just don't let him do it, right? And if you compare this to like the flow, right, as an organization, imagine you have to update hundreds of pages every month, you need to be publishing a lot of new content. This makes more sense to me, you know, in my particular case, because a normal people, what you would do, you someone introduced the error, you need to wait at some point to crawl and monitor the site, you will compile a report that will tell you what happens, and then you will find the guy who actually broke it, pitching the idea why that was a bad idea. This guy may not do it or not do it, but at that point you may be able to fix it, but that's 6 months down the line, right? But so the other bit is, straight in the platform, the guy fuck up, get a notification, and until he is able to do this, he may not be able to publish. And this is stuff that I think is really important, because again, you know, especially when you go into a large organization and we fit in that problem. Initially this platform was used by a couple of people, now we have like in the order of like a dozen of people in marketing teams who are publishing on this, and it's good, right? We love them to use it, but at the same time we don't love them when they screw up our ranking because they get creative. And then the second bit is all the people in our team that build content, edit content, publish landing pages and do SEO. So one thing that we got really obsessed to the point that we had an analyst measuring the speed at which we were publishing pages and all that kind of stuff. Because like our website had no pages, right? So that was my best way to grow. We started to build a set of features to make the guy that worked in our team faster. The first one are just simple searches, right? So well, you want to optimize a bunch of articles where we have where we quote other companies and we need to update the links every year and then. Just do a simple plain text search that you can search our CMS and database around that. We did that thing for render content as well. I don't think this is JavaScript, but I think what we do, for instance, we use Markdown in the backend, and we let the guys figure out where, in this example, you know, we have articles where we have table, where we compare our price with other people. What we do, we let them find the tables that are broken and prevent the Markdown from really publishing. And this is really simple, right? This is literally a screenshot of the guy that we have in our wiki. Any one of the content guys without having a clue on how most of this stuff eventually works, they can go inspect the element of this table that is built through Markdown, they can find the HTML, get the HTML and extract it, copy it, and then they can get this into Looker, just edit a bit to filter the advanced matching, and basically that's done. You know, they will find all the places where this is broken, and we can also automate this eventually at some point. And then the other bit is sync with all the SEO operation. There's a lot of things that we do as SEO that, again, don't have a very strict relationship with the flow, right? Imagine you want to make the perfect flow. Go back to the example of like doing a Formula One pit stop, right? Well, these people, they need to be very well synced, otherwise that is going to take one day. What we do, we try to embed all the operations straight into the platform. An example of this is that we use SEMrush, the writing assistant, to do some of our article briefs, which basically does what Yoast does on WordPress, some kind of checks on making sure that the article that we originally planned actually ended up being what we were saying with the right keywords, so that is integrated, people can go to check it quickly. Think about the similar thing as crawling your own site and compiling a report, any keyword report, right? At the point at which we publish a page, because we have these keywords.
I think it's okay.
We have this keyword from the brief, we can put this keyword in the platform, press the update button, publish. With API, we're going to send automatically this keyword to stats, and they're going to be categorized by the category on our blog, and happy days, we don't have to need another guy who download a bunch of keywords, who do an update on the platform, and blah, 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 and we take lots of time. And this works, right? Obviously, it's not just that, but like what we do to figure out whether any of this stuff makes sense or not, we look at how fast we can publish content. Again, we are in a situation where we have to rush to publish content to become a meaningful web portal versus being a one-page website. But reality, what happened is that our team, and the process of our team, got eventually faster because some of this stuff happened. And then the other bit, what we try to do again for people using a platform, is the validation element. So when it comes to them publishing pages, we hooked up a Google experiment, I think it is. The person has to create two pages, create the experiment, take the key, add it to the platform, it's this bit here, and then press the button, that will automatically trigger and launch the experiment, trigger the experiment, and then we already have some sort of A/B testing. We're deprecating this, that's why I put that symbol, because probably we're going into a little bit more rigorous split testing rather than using the GA, because then it gets sampled and stuff like that. But point being is that, again, anything that can help your team and operation to get to learning faster or to operate faster, that stuff is really important. And then the other bit is that, so at this point, right, we ensure that people don't fuck up, because we have some monitoring, we ensure that people know how to do this stuff faster, yet this is not fast enough, right? It's not fast enough because humans still make mistakes, and people in our team still have to go on, right, at night, and we cannot keep growing at the impressive speed otherwise. And how do we make our, and again, some of the stuff that we mentioned before, yes, we'll help you to make the Tumblr links type of SEO faster to the speed at which you can grow new stuff, but probably not enough. And using API is the next bit. In order to do that is relatively simple, I would say. First thing is people need to know their own CMS, right? So those blocks of text equal to these blocks of in the backend, which equal to this JSON, which does basically say that, oh, if there I have a title that say how to send money to Brazil, there will be a bit in here that does how to send money to Brazil in JSON. If you learn how to read your page, in this case we have JSON, we run a Postgres database, but point being is that if you learn how to read how the structure of your page is built, again, you can do this. I don't think that probably not all CMS, they got this capability, but like WordPress has got that, so you can, it's not really limited to what you need to do. After you build this and you understand exactly how this page work out in JSON, what we can do, we can leverage this API to make changes at very high speed. And some of the use cases, the most simple one is to create new pages, and then the other one are about updating what is there, which is eventually becomes a massive deal that you are dealing with very large amount of content. So let's go through this example quickly. I should have 2 minutes still. So on the optimization front, we have 200 pages with wrong canonical and wrong, where we realized that the title works optimized. This is very basic stuff, but you could do literally this with the same thing with anything. What we do, we prepare a bunch of changes in a simple CSV. We get the right page ID. We get the path just to validate that we don't change the wrong page. We put the change in there, and after that we wrote a Python script that take that JSON and emulate these changes. Just to give you an idea, right? This might seem fairly technical, but the two people who are building the monitoring and the person who is working on this optimization. What is the learning in terms of like what did we learn on the, let's be a little bit careful. One is something that you definitely must do is escape whatever dependencies you have from a development standpoint in building any of that. right? Back in time, we had TransferWise was on a monolith in Angular that we could have taken down the entire company, 2 billion, 3 billion a month worth of payment infrastructure by changing a footer link on the home page. We started to modularize our stuff and then our own independent folders and services that publish this. The other bit is that we don't limit our recommendation to just, oh, you know, we need to fix that title, we need to fix that table. We try to go deep on what to change, and then we treat the user, or at least we try our best. I'm not sure that we really do our best, but we should treat the user like customers of the platform that they use, and they have KPI, whether how much they get it right, how fast they are, and how much this is working. The other bit on the worry side is that obviously sometimes you don't have developer time, you don't have resources, and the risk is that you wait 2 years to build a feature that, you know, if you would have tested a set of pages on a WordPress on a separate domain, probably in 1 day it would have done, right? And the other bit is that be careful with what you build, because then you have to maintain it as anything, right? It's a similar example of like having a WordPress with adding all these beautiful widgets and at some point build a monster. Most of the stuff, we try to hack it as long as we can before we actually develop it, because there's a risk that we develop some fancy stuff, the GA experiment is one, that actually we don't use it at some point because we don't trust the data. And then in terms of learning, it's going to go really fast. One is a full stack team. That's what we really believe is important. Otherwise, we always have SEO, like telling what didn't happen rather than what happened. The other one is constantly define what the platform does and what the user should do. The second bit is monitoring inside the platform. The third bit is like invest in the operation, because that is what eventually drives, you know, your best competitor. You can both get it right on what to build, but who builds it faster with a benefit. And then the other bit is that you want to scale API do, and that's what we incentive to do if you want to grow faster and build the best CMS out there. And that's it. Thank you. You have links here to the slides, and you know, thank you.